Hello and greetings from Iceland. In this update, I will be looking into the current situation as the eruption is powering down. And I'm also going to look into the future from different scientific views that have surfaced with the lava in the last several days. But as for the eruption, it goes as we expected. It developed into three short fissures from where it's forming craters now, and it will most likely be the central crater that will outlive the others, as things look now. But somehow, it would not surprise me if this would go on for some time or more, even weeks. And one of the characteristics of this eruption turned out to be fast lava flow, as a direct consequence of the fact that this fissure has little by little been building up, so the path of the lava is simply steeper now. And the lava was causing troubles again yesterday, as it was threatening to take out the power line to the main grid, but firefighters were able to cool it down by the pylons that actually looked like this after the last repair and update. And I will shoot videos from this same angle again when things cool down to show you the changes, but the pylons are safe for now. And the Blue Lagoon, they are going to open it on November 29th, less than a week from now, which is quite optimistic since they don't have any car park there anymore. But if they can get the buses running, they can always offer tours from Reykjavík or Keflavík. But they are, however, working on fixing this. And I'm curious to see how that will work out. One option is to remove the new lava from the car park, but it's still glowing hot and thick, so I don't see that solution coming very soon. But another solution would be to do like the road workers have been doing after eruptions. Just make a new car park with a fresh layer of gravel on top of the lava, so the cars will be warm and cozy when the Blue Lagoon guests leave. But they have also the option to make a new car park within the area that the lava burns cover. And I think it might be the solution, at least for some time until things cool down. And the complete area is actually still closed for tourists. And Grindavík as well. The town was actually reopened recently. And I'm leaving a link to a video that I shot recently, the day when the town opened. And I do expect the town to reopen soon. Likely when the Blue Lagoon reopens, since we are likely moving into better times. We might have 2 or 3 months with less risk and attention. And it would not surprise me if many of the former residents in town will use the chance to stay home during Christmas. But as for the longer future, it's harder to work that out. But as for the short-term prediction, I have both good and bad news. The good news is surely the fact that this particular chapter might be coming to an end. And it was Professor Þorvaldur Þórðarson that was among the first to point out how the magma influx to the upper magma chamber was fluctuating before eruption number 6 in August. But many of his colleagues were not buying into that back then. But it became even more obvious before this eruption, number 7, that something was different. So the experts have started to feed my channel again with good talking points. And I'm starting with Professor Magnús Tumi Guðmundsson. He is always very careful, but expects this chapter coming to an end soon. This might have been the last eruption, in his opinion, but one or two more, they would not be a surprise either. So he has obviously changed his mind since just a few months ago. But it was another comment from him that struck me as a bit odd, or this sentence: there won't be any eruptions on the Reykjanes Peninsula for the next 100 or 150 years after this chapter comes to an end, because that is how the Reykjanes Peninsula has behaved in the past. And his opinion is based on lava volume from those 10 eruptions since 2021, that is in fact similar to the first chapter of the last active period on the Reykjanes Peninsula. But that was a long time ago, between 950 and 1240. But this theory of his about this interval over 100 years, it goes against the widespread view that when the Reykjanes Peninsula starts, The activity will move between systems spanning a period of 200 years or more. There might be some interval between chapters, but nothing like those 100 or 150 years. So that is not what we have been expecting, according to most of our experts. So I'm having a hard time buying into that theory that we will be on solid ground after this chapter by Grindavík comes to an end. So let's check out what another professor, Ármann Höskuldsson, was saying. He's a volcanologist and not as careful as his colleague, Magnus Tumi. So his comments are often very useful for my channel. And this is what I like to do. Listen to different voices, compare them and form my own opinion that way. And I will be citing two interviews this time with Professor Ármann. The more recent one is just a few days old. And he was saying that the Sundhnjúkar fissure row, where the eruption is now, is located at the edge of the Eurasian plate. And when the release of tension ends at that part of the plate boundaries, the tension will likely move to another old fissure row, or the so-called Eldvörp craters. So this is not over for him, actually just starting. Because he is also saying that the activity might even move all the way to the westernmost part of the peninsula, where we find a tourist attraction that is called the Bridge Between Continents, which is the west side of this very broken belt, where the North American and Eurasian plates meet, and of course the root cause for what we are going through. So Grindavík and the Blue Lagoon, they are situated almost midst between those two very lively parts of the plate boundaries. And those of you who have been with me here on the channel for long enough, you might remember all the trips I did with the thermal camera before the November 10th event, the magma runoff that split the ground under the town. But a week before that event, we were expecting the eruption to come up by the Eldvörp craters. And I made many videos about that. So Eldvörp is nothing new in this discussion. But why the professor assumes that the tension release will move to those craters remains unclear, although it is not a total surprise. And I do actually have a video online about those craters. For some part shot with a thermal camera, and I'm linking to it. And it also covers the connection between the craters and an offshore magma chamber that has actually been shaking quite a bit. So that video of mine is still valid as a good source for speculations. But let's not make this too complicated in this video. Professor Höskuldsson was also saying recently that the so-called Krýsuvík Trölladyngja volcanic system has already woken up, and it seems as it is just a matter of time when the system goes off full force. And with all those earthquakes in that system and everything else that has been going on, it's a bit hard to sell me the idea that after those eruptions by Grindavík, we will be just fine for the next 100 years or more. And if it would be the case that the next chapter takes place by the Eldvörp craters, what would it mean for the town and the infrastructure? And to make that short, it's worse news for the power plant and the Blue Lagoon than the town itself. For some parts, it enjoys this shelter from this hill by the mountain Thorbjörn, in addition to already made lava berms. And what we know already is that most of the lava from those craters would find their way into the sea, but not all of it. So it would pose a threat to the Blue Lagoon, but it's even worse news that just by the Blue Lagoon, we find some of the youngest craters on the peninsula, just a few hundred meters away from the hotel. And that is where I did many of my thermal scans a year ago. And those craters are still hot, although I can't say if it is the norm. But I will know more after my next tour there. So if the professor is all right and the elder craters will wake up again, or maybe even just a new fissure, it is very easy to see that such an eruption could wipe out the facilities there. The town itself has a way better chance to survive than the Blue Lagoon in the long run. But I'm of course not in the position to say who of those professors are wrong or right, and one must have a certain respect for the role of researching, especially the fact that they are mapping the unknown. It's good to remember that before we start mocking those guys, especially those who dare to express opinions, because not all of them dare to do so. But when they do, I get good talking points to work from like now. And this is a big task for the science community to explore this series of events. So we can only hope that it teaches them a lot. But as for the status right now, we expect the worst to be over soon. And my plan is to go to the Reykjanes Peninsula in the next few days, at the latest shortly before next weekend. And I expect that all restrictions will be lifted by then, so I can just do my things in peace. Do some thermal scans, and I also need time to line up the drone to get some shots from the same angles as I was shooting from a year ago, because it helps me to make good before-after videos. And it's just so weird to look at this landscape today, knowing that this was only a year ago. So that will be my video approach to eruption number 10. And this leaves me with some time for updates as well. It's not easy to do them as I want to do them while I'm on the road and staying as a guest in Reykjavík. So it's still plenty to come from me. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the volcano island, Iceland.